And he's by the name Prophet Austin Moses of a ministry known as Divine Ministries International. And you know what? I think a few days ago, I visited the church premises, went into the building, and I saw a church that's ready for takeoff. It's beautiful premises. It's a place where you feel at home, you feel relaxed, and you really enjoy what God has for you in that place. Very important. So, you know what? We're going to have a wonderful time this morning with this great man of God. Welcome to the program, sir.
God bless you, man.
It is well with you, sir.
And you too, sir. God bless
you. Yes, I know a lot of people don't fully know, you know, they see you, and I know you're a no-nonsense prophet. But the thing is, why is it, just a quick question, why is it that some prophets tend to compromise? You don't know whether it's easy to please the people, to make the people feel good by telling them all sweet things all the time. But you come sometimes, and some things you deliver, they are heavy, heavy stuff.
The first thing is, I know who sent me. I always say this, that life is not supposed to be about who you are. WHO. Life is supposed to be about whose you are. WHOSE. Whose you are. Because who you are might fail you, but whose you are will never fail you. A man of God on God's assignment should believe in who have sent you. One thing that God keep on dropping in my spirit is this. I am the one that called you. So look up to me for the provision of the assignment that I've given to you. You might be looking at it to take off very big, but maybe I am saying start small. So a true prophet of God must not and should not compromise the word of God. Not everybody will like you. The ministry of a prophet is a lonely ministry. Is a ministry where people push you aside because they believe that you speak the truth. But if you begin to compromise the word of God, the true word of God, because of what people will say or because you wanted to bring the money, when they bring the money, whose work are you going to use the money on? It's not God's work. I always tell God, mine is to make myself available for you to be used. Whenever you need me, you send me, I am there. Yours is to make the provision. There's something I always say, Pastor Amy. I am a spiritual goat for God. Let me explain that one.
Wow.
Back home in the village, when you tie a goat down, you restrict the goat from going to the bush and look for food. So therefore, it has become your responsibility, because you tie the goat down, to go into the bush, even when it's raining and the goat is making noise because of food. You have to go into the bush to look for what the goat will eat. So he called me. I was doing my own thing. He called me. He sent me forth. I didn't want to do it. He arrested me with iron fists and said, you must do my work. Okay, fine. I surrender. I started a business. In Jamaica, the Lord took it away. I started one in Nigeria, he took it away. I started a business here in the UK, he took it away because I was running away. He was calling me, I said, okay, I will do your work. But first, let me establish my business. So I will be using the profits from the business to run the ministry. Because I hate insult, I don't want to depend on tithe and offering. So Father, please wait, I will do it, but let me. He said, no, it's other way around. I started it, he took everything away. The last one, the third one here, cosmetic business, everything got out the drain. He said, are you now ready to do my work? I said, Father, I am ready. He said, listen to this. Because if I allow you to progress in your business, and the good thing about the business is, when I first started those business, they were picking up. Just to prove to me that you're not a failure. After a while, everything will go down the drain. Why? Because I didn't send you. He said, if I allow those business to prosper, and then you begin to finance the ministry from this business, you will think it's because of that business. That's why the ministry is succeeding. I'll tell people, Pastor Yemi, whatever that belongs to God, whatever assignment that God has put in the hands of a man of God, he will not allow anyone to take the glory. He will not allow anyone to take the glory. Because if people come and support and things just going on well, they will take the glory. They will take that assignment through a very rough period, rough time, that he only will be the one that will show up. After you have tried everything you know how to do, it will work. It will just be looking at you. At the end, you say, God, my hands up. You will not step in. That's why we call it the God that do what no man can do. If things are working all well for us at all times, we don't need God.
That's right.
So man have to fail for God to pass. If man keep on passing, God, there will be no room for God. So man must fail in order for God to come in, step in, manifest his power, and pass. So any true prophet of God must not compromise the word of God. If they don't want to bring the offering, so be it. The work belongs to God. God will never allow his work to suffer. Do not depend on man. No way. Depend on God. God bless you.
God bless you, sir. Thank God for your life. I know that God has used you mightily in the life of so many. And a very important person in whose life he used you also was a man of God by the name Pastor Sunday Adelaide.
Yes, sir.
And I remember he himself said something. He said he became weary of prophets when he saw so many of these funny prophets. He said, but then when the word of God came through you, he said, he thought, wow, this cannot be ignored. I'm sure we got the clip already in the studio. I just hope the technical guys can actually release that clip right now so that people have an idea of what is going on. So you know what? Just sit back and watch this. When we come back, we hear more from the man of God.
I met Prophet Moses.
Talk about Moses Nazad.
1 month ago.
He
was writing to me the last summer, the last year.
Maybe I should speak English.
Yeah.
Okay. He wrote to me last summer.
Он написал мне прошлым месяц, прошлым летом.
That he has a word for me that is a prophet of God, and God showed him to me, and that he should give a message to me, but not by email. He wanted to come to deliver the message in person.
Он написал мне, что он пророк Божий, что у него есть послание от Бога для меня, но что он не хочет написать мне его просто в письме, а хочет увидеться со мной лично.
To cut a long story.
Чтобы короче сказать.
He came and brought the message to me.
Он приехал и передал мне это слово.
And you can't believe it.
Вы не можете себе представить.
I can't believe it.
Я не мог себе представить.
He said,
он сказал,
the first message,
первое слово.
Because I neglected the thing,
потому что, в принципе, я не отнесся к этому.
He wrote to me in June, and I just threw
он написал мне в июне, в прошлом году, в июне, и я просто отложил письмо.
But when the crisis began...
Но когда начался этот кризис,
Thank God for trouble.
Спасибо Богу за проблемы.
So I said, oh, but there is this guy who said he's a prophet. Let me come and hear what he said. What?
Я вспомнил, вот так там был этот пророк, который об этом писал. Надо его пригласить, чтобы он сказал.
Then he told me, I saw a division.
И тогда он сказал, что я видел видение от division, разделение.
Some people are falling away from you and accusing you, and it's just everything we were going through. So, why didn't I call him on time?
Он сказал, я увидел, как некоторые отпадают вообще от тебя, а другие, наоборот, остаются с тобой. И я подумал, Боже, а почему я тогда не обратил на это внимание?
You know, that was my first encounter with him.
Это было первое впечатление.
But we had still not met. Just wrote to me. So,
он просто написал мне, мы не встречались.
Then, you remember, you church members know, on the 2nd of January, when the police came to my house to conduct a search and everything.
И вы церковь помните, когда 2 января ко мне ворвались вооруженные милиционеры и делали обыск в моем доме.
Take my passport.
Забрали паспорт.
You know, that a day before then, I just got a text message from him.
За день до этого я получил сообщение на телефон от него.
Pastor Sunday, don't be afraid, but I see your passport being taken and you've been limited. And so the next day it happened. I said, where is this man coming from?
Там было написано, что пастор Сандей, вы не бойтесь, но завтра на вас будет налет, и у вас заберут паспорт, но все будет нормально. Я думаю, ничего себе. Поэтому, когда этот человек, пророк Моисей, он говорит что-то, я уже серьезно слушаю то, что он говорит. Очень серьезно.
So, church, I want you to take it very serious.
Поэтому, церковь, я хочу, чтобы вы отнеслись к этому очень серьезно.
I receive it that it, I think I always have that witness in my heart.
Я чувствую, что у меня всегда это было свидетельство в моем сердце.
They might kill me today.
Что они могли бы убить меня сегодня.
Ukraine might reject me today.
Они могут отвергнуть, Украина может отвергнуть меня,
they might put me in jail today.
Что сегодня они могут поместить меня в тюрьму,
they might do anything against me today.
И могли бы сделать все, что угодно со мной.
But a day will come.
Но я знаю, что придет время, час and и день.
You also know this.
И вы также это знаете.
But I only am not sure if it's going to be my lifetime or I'm not going to live to see it.
Которых нет в живых.
But I...
Wow. I hope you enjoyed what you saw. Well, I just get the man of God to just in a nutshell, just tell us exactly what it's all about. Just in a nutshell, sir.
In the video?
Yeah, the video.
Yeah, it all started in June 2008 when the Lord brought him to be my dream. The first time I saw him was on Revelation TV with you. Then in June 2008, the Lord brought him to me in my dream, and then he gave me a word for him. And he told me that I must travel to Ukraine to meet him and give him the message face to face. I sent email to his office that June 2008. There wasn't any reply or response from the email I sent. June, July, August, September, October, November, December 2008, I received a mail from him that requesting for my number that he wanted to speak with me. So I jumped on the computer. As I was typing my number, prior to that, the Lord have told me that I must not speak with him on phone. I must go to Ukraine to give him the message face to face. As I was typing the number, the Lord spoke to me and said, so now you want to disobey me and honor man. I rub it off. I sent a message to him saying, man of God, I'm very sorry. The Lord still insists that I must not give you my number. That was it. I didn't hear anything from him. The third day after that email, in the morning, the Lord said, go and send your phone number to him. I didn't ask God the reason why. I sent the email to him with my number. That same night he called me. That then the Lord that gave me some other message to deliver to him. But the other one, he said, I must still go to Ukraine to deliver the message to him. So on January 1st, 2009, a friend of mine invited me and my family for dinner. As we were eating, the Lord said, bring out your phone. Send this message to him, tell him the authority they are coming to withdraw his passport from him. Then I sent him the message. Man of God, I'm very sorry, this is what the Lord said I should tell you. And he replies, okay, don't worry, I will be waiting for them. That was January 1st, 2009. January 2nd, between 7 and 8 a.m., the police came to his house. They withdrew his passport from him. They now called me and said, oh, please, we need you here now. We arranged, that's where I traveled to Ukraine for the first time. When I met him, the Lord said I should release the message. I released the message. He now told me that the very first day he wrote to me and I wrote back, that the Lord still said I must not give him my number, that he went into 3 days fast and prayer, telling God to please let your prophet release his number because I need to talk to him. I'm desperate. That was why the Lord not spoke to me the third day that I should give him my.
Wow.
God answered to his prayer.
Wow.
So we really thank God, man.
Amen.
Of God.
Amen. Wow. Time is really, really gone.
Yes.
But I know you have a message for the now.
Yes.
For the body of Christ.
Yes.
I just want to give you a few minutes to deliver that message, then we'll talk a bit about your book and the ministries.
Yeah. The message came early hour on Sunday morning. I remember I woke up at around 8 a.m. Then I took up my pen. I started writing the message, about 8 pages. I saw myself in one of my car, the blue Honda. I was driving the car. The car was not moving fast. I had one of my daughter at the back of the car. The car was not moving fast. I look at the time, it was 1 p.m. And I needed to be at where I was going at 2 p.m. And I said, oh, we have just only about 1 hour left. This car is not moving fast the way I expected. I said, okay, let me drive back home.
drop the blue car and I take the black Honda to the place. All of a sudden, I saw myself got out of the car, that blue car, walking on top of a hill with my daughter. I left the car, I took some things that I could take from the car. Other still left in the car, and I said to myself, when I get on top of the hill, I will come back to take the rest. By the time I looked back, I saw my little girl carrying the rest in her hand with me. I said, wow, she will carry those things. And as we were going on top of the hill, I saw one of these Nollywood actresses in Nigeria, she's very popular if I mention her name, driving a beautiful blue car, elegantly dressed with her son in the car. We were both going towards the top of the hill. I was walking with my daughter. She was driving the car. And I said to myself, look at this woman. She is doing things of the world. Look at how she's living a flamboyant life, a good life. But look at me, working for God. And she's driving the car and I'm walking on top of the hill. We got on top of the hill. Then I greeted her. We exchanged presents and then she drove off. We got on top of the hill. Lo and behold, it was a farmland, a big farmland. On that farmland, there were heaps. The one for yam, the one for potato, for corn. She was admiring those farmland and the potatoes and the cassava and the corn on the land. And I walked up to her, I said, this farm belongs to me. He said, you mean you? I said, yes. He said, and you planted all these things? I said, yes. She now went under the cassava tree and dug it, and she found just a small tuber of cassava just coming out. I said, wow, this is amazing. I said, I planted this cassava just 3 months ago. It's already producing. She said, oh, you are very lucky. And the Lord started speaking to me. He said, there are many men of God on the journey that I sent them, but they are comparing themselves with other people. He said, look at it now. This woman is admiring what you have on your farm. But when you were planting that farm, planting things on that farm, she was busy doing things of the world. Now it's time for harvest. In the farm, she had nothing to harvest. She's admiring what you have planted. Though when you were walking on top of the hill, you were complaining. There are many men of God. God has sent you an assignment. You are complaining. To you, you might think that you are not doing. Listen to this. Whenever God gives you an assignment, as long as you know that you are doing what God has sent you to do, you might be thinking that there's no result. But to God, there's a result, because the way we see result is not how God sees the result. He says, so go and tell my men that I've sent on my mission, provided that they are doing what I call them to do. They might not see the result physically, just like me. I was walking on top of the hill without a car. But at the end, there are things that are prepared for them. That is phase one of the revelation. Phase two of it, I now saw myself in the church. There was service going on inside the church. I didn't enter inside the main church. I was at the entrance of the church. You know, when you open the door, the corridor. Yeah. I was there. I was wearing a white garment. And the leader of the church, who was conducting the service at the church, was also wearing a white garment. While I was sitting there waiting for the service to end, for me to see the man, a young boy, a very small boy, came in as well, wearing white garment. He saw me sitting there. He said, oh, I'm looking for so-and-so person. I said, well, I've not met him before, but I'm also here to see him. So I'm waiting for him. The service is going on. Then that young boy look at me. He says that I was, you know, just looking at him and this is a small boy. What can this one do? He said, you are a very good, let me. He said, you are a very good prophet of God. It's part two of it. Okay? Six. I wrote it here. Capital letter. He said you have a very good heart and you're a very good prophet. He said there are many other prophets out there. They deceive the people, they take the money from them, and they keep the money to themselves. He said, but you, even out of you not having, you're still giving out to people. He said, do you know there are times that you give to people by faith, meaning that you, the last one you have, though you have need for it, you will still give it out, believing that God will provide for you too. I wrote it here. He said, keep up with the good work and God is happy with you. I look at him. I almost started crying, that because what he said was true.
Yeah.
As we were saying that, the service ended, the leader of the church came out. I didn't know him because I have not met him before. I saw them came out. I moved towards the people. I said, please, I'm asking for. He said, yes, I'm the one. He said, you are very lucky for coming here today. He said, because I was just about going on a journey, and I will come back in 3 years' time. He sat down. He said, you sit down. He asked me a question. I wrote here. It's about 3 feet. 1 minute. Okay? He asked me this question. He said, can the spirits of adultery and fornication dwell among my people? I said, no. He said, the adulterers and the fornicators cannot stand before the Lord. Chapter number one, close. Chapter number two, he looked up at me and he said, regarding the time, he said, the time is very short. He said, go and tell them, everyone that will listen to this message, he said, after they've heard this message, he said, I will come back to visit them again in 3 years' time to see if they have put things right or not. This was the message I shared to members of my church on Sunday, and the whole church was quiet. And I believe that some of them are watching it now, watching this program. The whole house was quiet. This is the message for the body of Christ. He knows the best, and he wants us to do things right, so that by the time he comes back to visit us, he will meet us well. And for everyone who is watching me right now, I pray that the Lord will give you that spirit of enablement to begin to do his will in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Wow. Man of God, this is serious. And you know, when you go on Facebook, you see some revelation being posted there by ordinary Christians like us, saying that they had an encounter with the Lord, that the time is near. The time is near. And when you look at things happening around the world, something is happening. There's a rumbling taking place.
Yes.
I had a revelation like that some months ago, where something was happening. There was like an earthquake in the UK here. But it wasn't an earthquake. It was like the ground was muddy. It was moving and buildings were collapsing. But nobody died. I didn't see anyone die. But people were angry. They were upset because they've lost everything they worked for. And I was there. I was going, what is going on here? Then I heard the radio, someone put on the radio, and on the radio the news came on, and someone said the same thing is happening in Europe across the channels. The same thing is happening. I thought, wow. So I just knew something is happening. God is about to do something.
You know what the Lord told me? 2009, even in Ukraine, when I was in Ukraine Pastor Sunday, I shared it from his pulpit with the members. The Lord said to tell his people that this recession going on, that he himself withdrew that money, is in his hand. I say, and I'm watching people. He said, tell my people, whoever that want to do everything possible to keep what they have, to save, to salvage what they have, they will lose it.
Wow.
He said, but whoever that desire my kingdom first, we gain from this earth and then we gain in heaven as well. So when you said the earth was moving and then they're angry because they lose everything, that's exactly what the Lord told me.
Wow, that's serious. Time is really gone, man of God.
Gone.
You got a book here, which says there is still hope for you.
Oh, yes.
Last time around when you came, I know you gave away 50 copies.
50 copies, yes.
But then because of the cost of printing,
oh, yes,
and ministry needs support,
yes,
were you saying that whoever can sow a seed to the ministry can,
yes,
actually?
What I even want to do is this. Last time I came here, I announced it here, which is very, very rare of me, but we need the support of the people to cut off with the word of God, work of God. That I need 300 people. I said here last time, 300 people who can be supporting us every month with £30. 300 people, because the work is large, is very, very large. So if you're out there and the Lord have touched you and you really want to support this ministry to enable the prophet to continue to do what God has called him. Listen, my God, the false prophets are still speaking because the genuine ones are not speaking. When the genuine prophet begin to speak, the first one will keep their mouth shut. And one of the ways for the genuine one to begin to continue to speak is when we get support from people. So if you're out there and the Lord have touched you, please support our ministry. When you support our ministry, I will send a copy of this book to you in Jesus' mighty name. Our church is just around the corner here. We are on the high road in Tottenham, and the postcode is N154BN. To get the details, please just call any of the numbers on the screen. And our Sunday service starts from 4:30 p.m. And like this evening, Wednesday, start at 6:30 p.m. And this Friday, every first Friday of the month, is our night vigil, starting from 10 p.m. And the Lord We richly bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Man of God, time is gone. There are some other things that I would really like to, I'd love to share, but because the time is gone.
I'll just give you about 2 minutes.
Two minutes, yes. You know, there's a difference between prophetic declaration and prophecy. I shared this in our church 2 weeks ago. I did a teaching on it. There's a difference between prophetic declaration and prophecy, because many Christians have taken prophetic declaration for prophecy. For prophecy, because the time is gone. So we maybe next time when I come, I'm going to share.
And you talked last time about actually when a prophet speaks, prophesies into your life.
Yes.
Your duty, your what you expected
we did that teaching. Yeah, we did that teaching 2 weeks ago.
Don't worry, we are going to come back and tidy it up so that people can be blessed.
Amen.
Man of God, I want to thank you so much for coming.
God bless you richly.
Amen. You know what? I want to encourage you. Please take down the details on the screen. Get connected with the man of God and his ministry. The ministry is in Seven Sisters here. Even though it's called Tottenham, High Street Tottenham, but it's just around the corner here from the Tesco in Seven Sisters. You can just pay them a visit. I was there a few days ago. I was impressed with the way the place is laid out. Beautiful and clean and wonderful. It's very, very cozy. And I thank God for the man of God, because I believe your God will use him likely to be a blessing to every one of us. So I want to thank God for your life, and I want to encourage you. Tell as many friends as possible where to go, because God is releasing his sons out. I know the funny ones have muddied up the water, but the sons of God are appearing on the scene. And when they appear on the scene, a lot of things will change. Thank you so much for being with us. And we'll be back with you same time next week. Whatever you do, don't touch that dial. God bless you, and bye for now.